I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend.
Hello everybody, my name is Harvey Brownstone. I am a dedicated Helen Reddy fan, have been all my life. It is my great honor to be interviewing Jim Keaton, who is the foremost authority on Helen, on her career, on her life. And he has graciously agreed to participate in this in-depth interview for serious Helen Reddy fans so that we can, for the purposes of posterity, memorialize her legacy, her work, her contribution to the entertainment industry in a way that can be accessible to all serious Helen fans. So Jim, thank you so very much for agreeing.
You're very welcome. It's a pleasure. Absolute pleasure.
Before we start, I must ask you if you could tell us about those gold records behind you on your wall.
Well, actually, I'm in the room in my house I call the Helen Reddy room because it's full of Helen's awards and gold records. And I can't show you the whole thing because I have a lot of things in boxes. But these are gold records, mostly from the ones behind me are from Australia, New Zealand, and Canada.
And these are things that Helen gave you?
Yes.
Well, she must have adored you because you have such a long-standing connection with her. You were, and I know you've talked about this before, so I won't spend a lot of time on this, but you were the president of her official fan club, correct?
Correct.
You organized many excursions by fan club members to her concerts.
Correct. To 29 states and three countries.
Including Canada, where I'm located.
Including Canada.
I only had the joy of seeing her perform twice, but you saw her, how many times would you figure? Hundreds?
Oh, thousands.
Thousands.
Literally thousands.
And what I really appreciate about you is that you were a friend. You saw the private Helen and the public Helen.
Yes. And you know, it's funny you say that. Well, this has not been that long ago. Somebody said to me, we were talking about Helen and something came up that I thought was a little too personal. And I said, I really don't think we should be talking about this. And he said, you're going to defend her till the day she dies. And I said, no, I'm going to defend her till the day I die. And that's how I feel about her. I mean, she is a friend. She will always be a friend. And she was a great influence on my life. So I owe her a lot.
Well, I personally appreciate your accessibility because she's one of the people in show business that to me is a bit of an enigma. And I say that to you because she was a massive presence in the world of entertainment in the 70s.
Yes.
When you and I, who are roughly the same age, were, you know, adolescents.
Right.
And you could not turn on an award show or a variety show or the radio without hearing Helen Reddy. And yet, I'm disturbed as a fan. Number one, I'm disturbed that with her divorce came an almost sudden disappearance.
Yeah.
But I'm also disturbed that she's being more and more portrayed as a one-hit wonder.
I know.
I think I Am Woman is a wonderful song. I understand how it launched her into superstardom. But does it bother you that people don't talk about the other songs?
Yes, it bothers me. I think part of that reason, though, is that because I Am Woman had such a strong influence on the culture. I mean, it's part of our culture. You hear, you know, on game shows, all kinds of shows, I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar, I'm Strong, I Am Invincible. I heard it just the other day on a show called Shameless, which I love. And they were talking about I Am Invincible. And without that song, that wouldn't have been part of the lexicon. But yes, there were so many more hits and there were so many things that Helen did that nobody ever talks about. And now that she's gone, and when they talk about her, it's only I Am Woman that gets mentioned.
Yes, and that really came out in the obituaries, in all the little snippets that the news programs used to announce her death. And part of me was proud and the other part of me was annoyed because personally, I don't think it was her best song. I hope I'm not offending you.
I think
she had some much, much better songs like You and Me Against the World.
You and me against the world. Sometimes it feels like you and me again. against the world.
And I can't say goodbye to you.
I can't say goodbye to you. No matter how I try, you're such a part of me. Without you, I would die deep in the heart of me. I know that you and I were meant to be forever. I can't tell you goodbye.
And the Barry Manilow song that I know is your favorite, Somewhere in the Night.
Lost in the feeling, so glad you opened my door. Come with me. Somewhere in the night we will know everything lovers should know. You're my song, music to magic to end. I'll play you over and over again. Loving so warm, moving so right, closing our eyes and feeling the light. We'll just go on burning bright somewhere in the night.
Yes.
And it troubles me. But anyway, I'm glad to hear that you also agree that she should not be remembered as a one-hit wonder. She was not a one-hit wonder.
Oh, she was definitely not a one-hit wonder. She had been performing since she was four. And so there were lots of things that she had done. I mean, TV shows in Australia, she had done hundreds of TV shows here. She had movies, plays, all kinds of things that are part of her legacy that never get mentioned. So
do you think it bothered her?
I don't know that it bothered her. I know that she was extremely proud, especially after the Women's March, of I Am Woman. She was always proud of I Am Woman because what it meant to her and the words meant a lot to her. But after the march and people were carrying signs that said, I'm strong, I'm invincible, or hear me roar, we were at lunch and I took the cover of the New York Post, of all things, to show her because there was a blow up of a sign that said, I am woman, I am strong, I am invincible. And I showed it to her and she started to cry. And aww. She said, you know, I still can't believe that people care about that song. And it wasn't that she didn't appreciate the impact of it. It was just, it was as strong now. And I think it's stronger now than it was before because of what still needs to be accomplished. And I think younger women are seeing that more clearly now than they had before.
Let me ask you about the movie.
Yes.
That wonderful biopic. How do you feel about it? Have you gone on record with a real analysis of what you think of the movie?
Well, yes, I like the movie. I enjoyed the movie. And I actually, the gold records in that movie are gold records that I loaned to the production company. So they would have the real thing. I worked a little bit with the screenwriter who is absolutely wonderful, Emma Jensen. She's a wonderful person. So she really wanted to get the story, but they based a lot of the movie on three events in Helen's life. So it was based on just three events, the 60s, the rise of I Am Woman, and what came after that, and then her retirement and the 80s. Performing at the Women's March in DC. So those were the only things. So I felt like because of the nature of how it was written, a lot was left out. And actually you can't tell Helen's whole life in 2 hours. So my personal opinion is I think they did a good job with the movie with the goal they had in mind. And I think it told the story well of what they were trying to tell. I just think there needs to be a documentary made about Helen's entire career and talk about more of what was going on in her career, not just I Am Woman, because that movie was really about the rise of I Am Woman and the impact of the song.
Do you know why they only used her real voice in two songs?
Well, I know that there were some issues with getting the rights to the songs. this is an opinion, but Capitol Records has not been overly cooperative over the years with, say, publicizing Helen's material. I mean, I want a box set. I think there should be a box set of Helen's material, and I think that should have been released a long time ago, but they have done very little. And when they do release things, it's the same songs over and over. So it's sort of like the greatest hits again and again. So I know that there were some problems getting the rights to the songs, but I don't know exactly what those issues were, other than money and capital not willing to discuss a lot of it.
Were you happy with the interpretation of the songs by the vocalist that they used?
Yes, I thought her name is Chelsea Cullen, and I thought she did a really good job. She actually, that soundtrack won an ARIA award in Australia for best soundtrack. And so I think she did a good job. I think she got as close as anyone could get to Helen's voice. Would I have rather heard Helen's voice throughout the whole thing? Absolutely. The beginning with You're My World, when yes. that opens, my heart just flooded. I thought, oh, well, this is going to be, 2 hours of crying. And there were some crying in there. But I just love the way it opened with her voice, and so strong. And that song is so strong. And it was such a good introduction to that, what was coming.
Did you think there was an overemphasis on Jeff, on the husband in the movie?
Well, one of the things that I thought I got a little bit of overkill was, okay, we got the drug thing. We know he was using drugs. And I thought that could have been maybe pulled back a little bit. We got the impact. We know what's happening. But I felt like that might have been a little bit overboard. Like the scene that really I was uncomfortable with is when he is sniffing cocaine from the carpet. I didn't feel comfortable with that. I didn't think it was really necessary to make the point, but I didn't produce or direct the movie. So I didn't make, that's not my decision to make. It made me feel a little uncomfortable seeing that.
Did Helen have anything to do with the making of the film?
She was involved. It was about 6 years in the making. Anju Moon, who directed the movie, had met Helen at an award show in LA, and they started talking about it. And yes, Helen had input into it. Helen's daughter and son had input into it. And Jeff was very involved in the making of it. So they all had input into it. And so they were involved. Let me just leave it at that.
So what do you say to people who, and I know people who said this after watching the movie, how does a strong, invincible woman who's a role model for independence and assertiveness and self-respect stay in a marriage with an obvious drug addict that long?
Well, I think part of it was Helen's philosophy, and she loved Jeff. I mean, there's a line in one of her songs that I always think of: the depth of my love would be the depth of my hate. And I'm not saying she hated him, but in most relationships, no matter whose they are, when they start to break up or they start to go sour, there's that push-pull. And for them, they lived it such in a public way that everything that happened was sort of the dirt. And so everybody was talking about it. It was in all the tabloids and everything. And Helen looked at it, and so did Jeff, as Helen is the show and Jeff is the business. He did all of the contracts. He did the negotiating and everything else. And Helen performed. They were a true team working for one goal. And then I think when all of that started to fall apart and the drugs became a problem, and Jeff owns his mistakes, he does not deny them. He does not blame anybody else. He accepts responsibility, and he talks about it freely, that it was a mistake. And if he could do it again, he would not do it again. But I think it was, when you love somebody, there's always that I'm going to give you one more chance kind of thing.
I think people don't appreciate how busy she was.
And that's another thing. There was constant performing. For instance, when her mother and father died, and when Lillian Roxon died, her friend, there's no canceling the shows. You have to go out there and you have to perform like you are the happiest person on earth when she is experiencing all of this emotional, absolute agony, and you can't express it. You still have to sing those songs happy and up and, like you would as if nothing had happened.
And I think if you ever watch interviews with other show business couples that broke up, people like Lucille Ball, Cher, they will tell you that it's a very complicated thing to be in a personal relationship in a marriage with someone who's also your business partner or manager, because there's contractual issues.
Yes.
And in a case, in especially in Helen's case, she didn't have a weekly sitcom with a regular routine. This woman was traveling all over the place. Right. She was incredibly busy in that decade of the 70s.
Yes.
I would imagine that a lot of that drug use, she didn't see it.
Well, I don't think she, I know, just because she was on the road all the time, that she didn't know it until the extent of it until it got really bad. Plus, in addition to that, she had two children to take care of. She used to fly back and forth from Las Vegas so that she would be there when the kids got up in the morning, and she would be there to put them to bed at night and then go do her two shows and come back for weeks at a time. That grueling schedule. I mean, you know, for those of us who are in a normal, so-called normal job, we can call in sick. She can't call in sick. She's got a show to do. And whether you have a sore throat or if you have a voice, you need to do it. And I've seen her do shows where she could hardly speak, but she did the best she could because people have paid money to see a performance and they're expecting that performance. And they don't really, I'm not saying they don't care, but they don't want to hear the excuse.
I think this is great that we've put this issue to bed. It's an important issue that people understand the context of the life she was living. Now I want to turn to the book. Yes. Helen wrote a book when she was fairly mature. I had more questions than answered at the end of that book. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered if you could answer some of them for me, if you're
maybe
comfortable. One of them is, why did she not name any of her husbands by their name? Why were they number 1, 2, and 3?
This is a personal opinion, and I didn't ask her that, but my opinion is she didn't want to give them any time in print. It was, you're number 1, you're number 2, and you're number 3. And at the time, there were still, you know, a lot of, I don't want to say animosity, but there was a lot of hurt between Helen and Jeff. And they did work that out, and they became friends or friendly toward, you know, the last maybe 6, 7, 8 years of Helen's life. And Jeff was always, I've said this before, and I will say it till the day I die, Jeff was always very supportive of me. And so I saw a side of Jeff that he was a good person to me. And so I was kind of glad that the all the bad stories that the National Enquirer and all those publications wanted to hear weren't in the book. I didn't want to know all those details. You know, a breakup, no matter how hard, is bad enough. But when it's in public and people are judging you for what you do and you should have left sooner. I mean, this is one of the things with domestic abuse. And I'm not saying Helen and Jeff was abusing her specifically, but I'm saying people make excuses and then they get blamed because you didn't leave. You should have left earlier.
Well, he stole all her money. Isn't that abuse?
Maybe. I think that is a form of abuse. Yes, I do.
That woman worked so hard.
Yes.
And then she goes to fill out a prescription in a drugstore and there's no, and the credit card is declined.
Right.
To me, I mean, I can't tell you how upset I was when I saw that in the movie.
Yes. Yes. That was a difficult time. It was, I mean, I'm not making excuses for that. It was extremely difficult. But at the same time, she had contractual performances that had to be done. So she still went out there and sang the songs. There were times when it's just show up, do the show, and leave as fast as I can because I can't take this anymore. I need some quiet time. And when you're in show business, you don't really get a lot of that. Somebody's always pulling at you. Somebody always wants something. So I think that was probably one of the most difficult aspects of that situation was the impact it had on her, knowing that her resources are dwindling or gone. And now what do I do?
I think one of the unusual things about her was that she was prepared to walk away.
Yes.
When you look at many, many, many vocalists who keep going on long after their best before date, you know, people like Sinatra, you know, Debbie Reynolds kept doing it all the way through. You could list many, many singers from the 70s who kept plugging their hits, appearing at smaller and smaller venues.
Yes.
Over the decades, because
yes,
They needed the money and they loved the applause.
Yes.
You know, people like Diana Ross, Cher, Bette Midler. I mean, they were all those were from the 70s. But Helen Reddy's ego must have been different than the typical star because she did walk away.
Well, her philosophy was, I want to leave while they still want more. I don't want to be one of those people who, like you're just describing, and I've seen some performers who are way past their expiration date. And I'm embarrassed to hear them sing some of their hits because they don't sound like themselves at all. They can't sing it anymore. And it's like, oh my goodness, could we just let this go? But when Helen said, I'm done, and she said, I mean, her final performance was in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, which is a wonderful place. And the symphony there. Yeah, she performed with the symphony and they were absolutely great to us. I tried to get front row seats and they told me we may not be able to do that because we have season subscribers. To make a long story short, the fan club of 37 members of us went and we had the first three rows and it was wonderful. And Helen sounded just as good as she did when she first started. Her voice was right on.
That's where I'm getting to. She was not one of those singers who had lost her voice.
Yes.
She actually sounded great when she returned to show business.
Yes.
I'm grateful that there are YouTube clips out there mm-hmm. where we can see her singing and her voice was miraculously. In fact, I think you probably saw her appearance on Marie Osmond's talk show.
Yes.
Yeah. That performance of You and Me Against the World was scintillating.
You and me against the world. Sometimes it feels like you and me against the world. When all the others turn their backs and walk away, you can count on me to stay. Remember when the circus came to town and you were frightened by the clown? Wasn't it nice to be around someone that you knew? Someone who was big and strong and looking out for you and me against the world.
Yes.
That woman still had it.
Yes.
And so she didn't need to stop singing because of a risk of being embarrassed.
Right. And it wasn't done with electronics. It was done with her. That was her. Not,
oh, I know.
You know, this auto-tune and all that stuff. None of that. It was Helen. She got out there. She sang it. She meant it. And that was
so her. On behalf of every fan out there who's dying to ask you this question, I'm going to ask.
Okay.
Did you try to talk her out of leaving show business?
Well, I told her. Well, see, my thing with Helen used to be if I could die in the front row of a Helen Reddy show screaming, I would die happy. And when she said, I'm retiring and I'm not going to do this anymore, I said, you do realize you're ruining my dream of dying in a front row of a Helen Reddy show. And she's, you know, she made fun of that. It was a joke. But when I didn't try to talk her out of it, but I told her that there's going to be a lot of people who miss you. But if you need the time for yourself, which is what she really needed, she needed a break. She had been doing this since she was four.
But she didn't treat it as a break. She made it sound like it was done.
I'm done. I'm over. It's over. It's past. It's another part of my life. I don't want to talk about it anymore.
In fact, there's an interview with her from Australia where she's standing on the balcony of, yes. I think it's her apartment in Sydney.
It is.
And the tone of that interview was that she was almost annoyed that people remembered that she used to be a big star.
And how would you best like to be remembered?
I don't care if I'm remembered or not. The important thing is that any good that I've done lives on.
Yes, I got that impression too. And I think sometimes she was a little bit annoyed that people like me, the fans, wouldn't let her move on from it. She wanted to go into hypnotherapy, which she did, and she studied, and she was always interested in that. She was an extremely spiritual person. And I think she wanted to explore that side of her life and pursue that, but the fans wouldn't stop saying, please sing, please sing, please sing. And I think it kind of got on her nerves. Would you please just stop saying it? And then though, the good thing was when she was ready to come back, she sang a duet with her sister for Tony's birthday. And she heard herself and she said, she thought, well, you know, that doesn't sound so bad after all. Maybe I want to do that again. And when she came back, I think she really, really enjoyed doing it because she did it on her terms and she sang the song she wanted to sing versus what some promoter or somebody else was telling her she had to do.
Let me ask you briefly about her movie career.
Yeah.
Considering the fact that Airport and Pete's Dragon were immensely successful, she was very well received.
Yes.
In both movies. Mm-hmm. Why do you think that didn't launch a bigger movie career for her like it did for people like Diana Ross and Cher?
Well, I think part of it was just in the making of movies in general. It takes so long. You like she used to say, you know, I would sit on set for 10 hours, I'd perform for 15 minutes, and then I'd go wait another 8 hours to come back and perform for another 15 minutes. So I don't think, and she never said this to me, but this is an opinion, I don't think she really enjoyed the process as much as she did the immediate feedback of having an audience there. When she was in concert, she could see whether things were going well or not. And she could adjust what she was doing to fit if it wasn't going well. When she was performing plays like on Broadway with Blood Brothers, that was probably one of the most powerful performances I have ever seen her give. When she sings, Tell Me It's Not True, it is just, I mean, it's incredibly powerful.
Well, and even people who didn't get to see that, you can hear it on the Center Stage album.
Yes.
Which is one of my absolute favorite Helen Reddy albums.
Yes.
We talked about Jeff. Suffice it to say, what I find remarkable is that a person who was such a drug addict was able to be so high functioning.
Oh.
It's just shocking to me. People probably know I'm a criminal court judge. I deal with my share of drug addicts in my work. Mm-hmm. I rarely see anybody who could be that high functioning.
Mm-hmm.
He managed not only her, but several other major stars.
Yes.
And with great success. He obviously had so much clout in Hollywood that...
Very much.
Do you agree that his vindictiveness at the end of the marriage was the reason why suddenly she became like a persona non grata in Hollywood?
Well, I think part of that was Jeff is very assertive. And I think people, and again, this is an opinion, I don't know this for sure, but I think people were a little intimidated by him. And so they didn't want, if they booked Helen and he said, don't do it, they didn't want to deal with the impact of whatever came afterwards. So a lot of them just avoided the issue altogether. The other thing that happened there was Helen started doing more plays. She started doing like Call Me Madam and things like that, where it was her decision to do it. For a long time, she didn't have a manager at all because she wanted to be the one making the decisions. And I think when you have somebody who you trust and they sort of betray you, it's hard to trust somebody else. And then after a while, her son, who I love desperately, he's a wonderful human being. She did a wonderful job raising her children and had a great relationship with them. And her granddaughter was just the apple of her eye. So he was managing her and doing a wonderful job. It started going really well again with the concerts.
It seems to me that she went to do plays because that was one area of show business that Jeff didn't control.
That's correct.
He couldn't influence them not to hire her.
That's correct.
Do you think that there was a lack of loyalty there in the business? I mean, this is a woman that appeared on the Carol Burnett Show, by my count, at least 5 times.
Well, and she did a lot of work with Carol. She did a lot of benefits. She did a lot of charity work. And she worked with a lot of people. And I don't know. And again, I don't know Carol, and I don't know what's going on in her life. And I like her a lot, and I respect her. But I was a little surprised that there wasn't more outreach when Helen died from people in the business to say, you know, I'm sorry, my condolences, whatever. I one person that I heard from almost immediately, actually there are several. One was Harriet Schock, who wrote No Way to Treat a Lady. Two, Becky Hobbs, who wrote I Can't Say Goodbye to You. Three, Elaine Boozler, who is a comedian who Helen helped, when Helen was hosting The Tonight Show, she wanted Elaine on with her because Elaine was funny and Helen wanted to give her a chance to, you know, to have a little bit of exposure, heard from her. And the one that surprises people is Paula Poundstone. And the reason that surprises people is Paula used to tell a joke about where did all the, there must be a Helen Reddy fan killer out there somewhere, because where did they all go? Yeah, it's like what you were just saying when Helen kind of, there, she wasn't there anymore. Where did all those people go that were buying all those records? But I got a card from her. And I think the reason people were reaching out to me is because of the Facebook page. I'm easy to reach out to, because the email address is there.
Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit about the Midnight Special, how it came to be that she was the permanent host?
It's funny you should ask that, because I made some notes about the Midnight Special because I didn't want to get this wrong. Actually, the way the Midnight Special started in at the beginning was Bert Sugarman, who produced it, wanted a show. The goal was to, they were trying to get the voting age changed from 21 to 18. And he wanted a show that came on after The Tonight Show because kids 18 to 21 were awake at that time. So there was nothing on TV for them to turn to. So he wanted something to sort of promote the voting age at 18. So NBC wasn't, he went to NBC with it and they weren't interested. So he bought the time to actually do the show himself. And Chevrolet contributed and helped him. And Helen, although she didn't host that show, was on the first show. And it did really, really well. And so NBC picked it up and it ran for 9 seasons, 350 episodes, and Helen hosted 40 of those. She also appeared on a bunch of others, but she hosted 40 of them. She was the so-called the permanent host from July 75 to March 76, but that just, her episodes when she appeared were very popular. So they wanted her appearing more. So that's how she kind of became the host. And most people don't recognize with the Midnight Special that, just like most show business, you don't go and everybody, you know, is there together. They perform the songs. Helen would go tape her introduction. And now, ladies and gentlemen, you know, the Pointer Sisters, and go home. And then so they would edit that together. So ladies and gentlemen, the Pointer Sisters, and the Pointer Sisters would come on and perform. Sometimes she did perform with people though, like the Bee Gees, Hamilton, Joe Frank and Reynolds, and other people, so that they could do duets. The other thing that I wanted to make sure that people are aware of is Helen's show itself. The Helen Reddy Show in 1973. Flip Wilson met Helen in the 60s when they were both in Chicago, and he really liked her. So when he had a series, and when he needed a summer replacement, they used to have summer replacements in that time. He wanted Helen to do it. So she was contracted to do 8 shows. And one of her goals was to get people on her show who needed exposure and who she could help with their career, because her philosophy was, on my way up, I'm bringing people up with me. So she had people that had either very little exposure or none at all. Like for instance, the Pointer Sisters made their debut on her show. And they give her credit for giving them a chance when nobody else would. Mac Davis appeared on her show, Peter Allen, Robert Klein, Ann Murray, Seals and Crofts, George Carlin. She had a lot of people that were having not as big a success as they should have, in my opinion, had at the time. So she was giving them a chance to have a national audience when nobody else was doing that. And that's one of the things I admire about her. She treated people with respect, and she never forgot that it was difficult to break into the business she wanted to be in.
Do you know if there was ever any discussion about the show being picked up?
No, there was. To my knowledge, there never was. There was some talk of writing other shows for Helen. There was one that was in development, and it actually wasn't even titled that I'm aware of, but it was about a single mother raising a child, and it just never went anywhere. There were several shows that were, you know, pitched, but just didn't go anywhere, at least 3 that I could think of.
Yeah, but, you know, it's a shame, because the variety show format in those days was very popular, not just Carol, but Dean Martin and Flip Wilson. and Sonny and Cher and the Osmonds and Andy Williams, she would have, she proved that she could host a variety show and do skits and do duets very, very well.
Yes. And that's actually one of the ways that I Am Woman started getting the airplay that it was getting. Women heard it from the movie Stand Up and Be Counted, which I have to tell you is not the best movie you will ever see, but it features I Am Woman. Women started hearing it especially and started calling to request it. Helen went on 19 talk shows. She rewrote a third verse of it, went on every talk show that would have her, basically sang that song, and it started getting airplay. The only talk show or variety shows that she would not do was Dean Martin's. And the reason she didn't is because of the way she felt that he treated women, you know, the gold diggers and all that stuff. And he treated them like objects, but everybody else she did, Carol Burnett, Merv Griffin, Mike Douglas, Bobby Darin, Bill
Johnny
Cosby,
Carson.
Johnny Carson many times, Glenn Campbell, all of them. If they were not Dean Martin, and I'm not saying she hated Dean Martin, she just didn't like the way he treated women, she would do the show.
Can you tell us a bit, Jim, how did your friendship with her evolve? I mean, we all know that it was Capitol Records that asked you if you would head up an official fan club.
Yes.
But it couldn't have been easy for you to penetrate her inner circle. Can you share some insights with us about how that happened?
Well, I, as you know, I grew up in the hills of West Virginia, and I was, I mean, when I say hills, I mean no electricity, no running water, no indoor plumbing, no nothing. And I knew from a very early age that I was gay, and I was from a Pentecostal, snake handling Pentecostal, and born again Baptist background. So I knew I was going to go to hell. There was no way around it. So I thought, well, I'll just kill myself, get it over with, and I don't have to go through all the pain between now and when that time comes. So I wanted to tell somebody, and I heard Helen sing, I heard I Don't Know How to Love Him first, and I loved her voice, but then I heard I Am Woman. And when she sang that song, she was being called all kinds of names. Oh, she got a telegram when she won the Grammy, when she thanked God because she makes everything possible, that began with, "You skinny, blasphemous bitch," and went downhill from there. So I thought, well, if she can take this, then maybe I can take it too. So I wrote to her, and I just laid it all out. I knew I would never meet her, so what difference did it make? She wrote back. And I don't know how Capitol Records became aware of me, but they did. And they called, and they said that Jeff was interested in a fan club, and would I be interested if they would help me? Now, at this time, I am about 16. I have no idea what a fan club is, but I thought, if Helen's asking me to do something, I'm going to do it. So I said yes. And it's almost like there's an angel that had that angel's hand on the top of my head and said, here, let me push you. Because there was a woman at Capitol Records named Lori Shipp, and I will never forget her. She took me under her wing, and she was wonderful to me. She called me all the time. She gave me Helen's itinerary. She sent me pictures if people wanted pictures. Anything I needed, she did for me. And then, so we started the fan club, I used to call people and tell them when Helen was going to be in their city, because we didn't have the internet, and a letter would take weeks, like it's doing now. And so it just, one thing led to another. And then I met Helen. The first time was supposed to be in 1973, but when I went to the stage door, the person who was in charge wouldn't even give them my name. So that didn't happen. But in 1976, Lori Shipp made sure that I got backstage. And Carol Burnett, funny, we were talking about Carol Burnett. When she met Cary Grant, she said she was so nervous that she didn't know what to say to him. So she just said, "You're a credit to your profession."
Yes.
And so when I met Helen, I was so nervous. I had an album, No Way to Treat a Lady, and I couldn't get it open. And, you know, it was still had the shrink wrap on it. And she said, "Would you like for me to do that for you?" And I said, "I don't know what else to say to you, so I'm going to use Carol Burnett's line, 'You're a credit to your profession.'" And she laughed and she hugged me. And from that moment on, it was every time I went to a show, she would either ask to see me or I would be at the stage door and see her. And when she signed that album, and she may have signed this to 100,000 other fans, I don't know, but it meant a lot to me. She wrote, "To Jim, my number one fan."
Oh, and you really are.
Love Helen Reddy.
Time for me to ask you, many years ago, I wrote to her and she sent me this
picture,
which I don't think you can see.
I can't, but I know which one it is. I can see enough of it to tell you which one it is. Yes.
So what I want to ask is that really her signature? Did she sign all those pictures?
Yes.
She really did.
She really did. I mean, there were some that, you know, when those fan services, when you write and say, you know, please send me a picture, and they mail you a postcard, or those were obviously stamped on there if they were her signature. They were never her signature, but they would stamp her signature on it. But the pictures like you're showing, the 8x10s, she signed them. And sometimes she would answer mail, and the ones that really got to her the most were kids. When a child wrote to her about, now I'm gonna get emotional, but things that were going on with them and pain.
You mean being bullied?
Being bullied and things like that. She always took the time to respond to them. There were so many times when we would be at lunch or out in public and a little kid would come up and be all excited because it's Nora, it's Nora, it's Nora from Pete's Dragon. And she always took the time to talk to them, to encourage them, to whatever they needed, she was there to try to help. And I just thought that was one of the things I'll never forget about Helen. She cared about the people around her. She would not ignore a street person or somebody that was like women's shelters. She supported them wholeheartedly. Battered children's shelters. She did benefits all the time for them. And she never forgot that there are people in this world who need others. And she was one of those people who did the best she could to help them.
Do you think that financially she was comfortable in her senior years with having so many years of not performing, not yes. recording new material? Was she well off and comfortable?
She was comfortable. I think she was very comfortable, and she was at the Motion Picture and Television Fund Country House, and I can't say enough positive about that place. It is absolutely wonderful. They are just incredible people, and she was happy. She was laughing. They had shows there. She did concerts there. She did game shows there. I mean, it was like a small Hollywood, because everybody that's there was in show business in one form or another. So there were all kinds of activities. She interacted with people. We visited her every 2 months until COVID. And then that was very difficult, not being able to go visit her. But she was always so happy, which is how I will remember her. There was never a time where she seemed miserable. You know, we all have good days and bad days. I'm not saying she didn't have bad days, but overall, she was happy, and she was happy to be alive, and she was happy to have known that she had an impact on people who still, it still mattered to her.
I think one of the most interesting things about her personality that comes through in interviews mm-hmm. is her intelligence. She was not flaky. She did not come across as egotistical or self-absorbed.
Right.
No, she had a real intelligence. She was articulate and highly intelligent when dealing with interviewers, especially men who sometimes did not treat her very well.
Oh, and I was going to say that it's men who to be honest with you, I don't know how she maintained the professionalism she did with the way some of them spoke to her, but she always did. And she always did it in a way that was respectful, firm, but this is the point, and I'm going to make the point. Like when someone would ask her, well, what do you call a liberated woman? She would talk about not liberated women, liberated people. It's when we're all treated equally, then we're all liberated. It's not, you know, bra burning and all that stuff. They tried to make it man-hating and angry and all that. She was a mother, and she was someone who knew what it was like to have to take care of a child on your own, and knew what it was like to have to go buy milk do you make a choice between milk or do you make a choice between diapers? I mean, there were times where it wasn't a choice. Eating SpaghettiOs, when in the movie, when she talks about Tracy eating spaghetti all the time, they really did eat a lot of spaghetti and canned, you know, Chef Boyardee type meals because it's all they could afford. But she knew what that was like and she didn't forget it.
Yeah, and then at the end of her marriage, she had to start all over again with mm-hmm. her voice and her name.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jim, I understand we've run out of time. I cannot thank you enough for taking the time to share your insights with us. I hope that everyone watching has enjoyed this as much as I have.
Oh, I could talk about Helen for days. So, you know, it's, I know you have a time.
Your sincerity and your wealth of knowledge that you're so willingly share both on the Facebook page and through the Reddy Report and through interviews such as this are greatly appreciated because many of us want to keep her legacy alive in more than just listening to her at home. We want to make it a public thing.
Yes, and I do too. And I just want to say one more thing. The number of people that are contacting me on the Facebook page is incredible. People that have never heard of Helen or have heard of her but didn't know anything about her career. I love that. And my way of signing off newsletters, letters that I've been writing to people for the last 50 years basically is keep listening to the best.
Well, Jim, I think the best is reflected in you. And the stars were aligned that day that you and her connected because the two of you brought out the best in each other and you have definitely enhanced and promoted her career in a way that I don't think anybody else could have done. And on behalf of all of the fans, thank you for the time you take to share your relationship with her, with all of us. You bring us closer to her. Thank you so much, Jim.
Thank you. It's a true pleasure.
Thanks for watching. Be sure to check out all the great interviews on the Harvey Brownstone Interviews YouTube channel. Don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell to be notified when new videos are posted.